God, you are good. All the time. And whoever finds Jesus,
finds life,
absolutely. Well, my name is Jeff, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope. And if you're visiting today, I don't believe it's an accident that you're here. I believe that every person who comes through the door, God brings for a purpose. Today, He wants to speak some truth into your life, some love into your life, and I'm honored to be just a small piece of that this morning. I'm really excited about what God's doing in Edie's life, and I want to encourage you and thank you for praying for her. I want to encourage you to continue to pray for her as God is transforming her life. Thank you for being a part of transforming broken lives like Edie's. When you serve, when you give, when you are a part of what God's doing at New Hope, you're a part of changing lives like hers. Thank you for being a part of that. Well, if you're visiting today, it's not an accident you're here. I believe every person who comes through the doors, God brings for a purpose, and He wants to speak truth and love into your life. I'm honored to be a small piece of that. If you're visiting, it's not going to take you long to figure out we're not a perfect church, and that's because we're full of imperfect people like me and my brother Dan there. But we're real serious about sharing Christ's love with broken people so that He can step in and transform their lives and our lives in the process. And so if you're visiting, let us know you're here. There's a communication card in your bulletin, looks like this. And if you would fill that out and at the end of the worship hour, take it to the Welcome Center out back and exchange that with us. We have a free gift we'd love to give you. We'd love to have a chance to connect with you that way. So please let us know that you're here today. Also want to encourage you, as you saw Edie in her baptism there just a minute ago, have you ever been baptized by immersion into Christ? Baptism, according to Scripture, is the most sacred ceremony on planet Earth. We read about it in Romans chapter 6 specifically. It tells us that in our baptism, three great things happen in one. The first is that we're united with Christ in baptism. That's similar to a wedding day. It's like you pledging the rest of your life to Christ. The second thing that happens is it says that we're buried with Christ in our baptism. And as we bury our old life, it's like our funeral. It's saying, I don't live to be in charge of my own life anymore. And then it tells us that we're raised to a new life with Christ in our baptism. So the symbolism is now I come out, it's like my birthday. It's a brand new life. What's new about my life? Now I let Jesus lead. It's about Him, not about me. And so if you've never taken those steps of commitment to Christ in baptism by immersion, I want to encourage you to make that commitment to Christ. To do that, you sign up on your communication card, name, phone number, email address, and then on the back, check the box that says baptism. We'll also do child dedications next week, so if you'd like to dedicate a child to Christ, you could check that box as well. But then I'll call you this week and make sure that you're ready to do that and make that commitment of baptism. So once you fill this out, just drop it in one of the offering boxes, tithe and offering boxes by the doors inside the worship center here, and then I'll be in touch with you this week. Well, I'm really excited about what God is doing through Heaven Fest and what He's going to do. As you heard earlier, our worship pastor Harold is intricately involved in this, and God has used him and the ministry that he works with, Conference Ministries International, right, that is putting that event on. But Harold is the instrumental, one of the key pieces of putting this whole thing together. And so we're so honored to have Pastor Harold as part of our congregation, and we want to support what God's doing there. They're praying for 10,000 people to come to know Christ. You can get tickets on HeavenFest, www.heavenfest.com. Let's just take one moment and let's pray for God's move at HeavenFest. Father, right now we just lift up to you this entire weekend, Lord, that will be coming up for Heaven Fest. And God, we pray that you would do a great move, a supernatural move. Father, we do pray in agreement with our brother, Pastor Harold, Lord, for 10,000 lost people to come to know you as Lord and Savior as a result of this weekend, that weekend, Lord, that will be coming up here shortly in 2 weeks. Father, we just... we pray that you would align everything that has to come together on every single aspect. And most of all, Lord, that you would show up in a huge way through this event and that people would come to know you. And may you be honored. Lord, we pray it in belief and trust in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So that weekend is July 29th and 30th. It's a Friday and a Saturday. And again, heavenfest.com. All the information's on the back of our bulletins, which I want to encourage you, always read the page on the back of the bulletin announcements so you know what's going on, how you can be connected, how you can be involved with what God's doing through the ministry of New Hope and even in our community. So make sure you check those things out. I'm also really excited about a worship and dance group called After the Due Order that is from Chicago that is going to be performing at Heaven Fest. And Pastor Harold said, hey, Pastor Jeff, we got this great opportunity and that has come about. So they are going to be with us on Sunday morning after Heaven Fest, July 31st. After the Due Order is the worship and dance group from Chicago. And they're going to be leading our worship for us that Sunday. So you don't want to miss that Sunday. We're going to do something different, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to just do one worship hour. So instead of, and it's all going to be at 11 o'clock. So those of you that are here right now, just be here right now, okay? Those of you that come to first hour, or if you sometimes come to first hour, we won't have first hour that Sunday. We're all going to meet together. So you're going to get to meet the other half of the church that you may not know as well that comes first hour. And first hour is going to get to meet you guys. It's very rare that we get to come together as a whole church like this. This is a great opportunity for us to do that. So I want to encourage you, invite your friends, invite your family. These are the most passionate worshipers of the Lord I've ever met. And I prayed about, Lord, you know, what would you want me to say on that day? And I'm going to do a short message on that Sunday about passionate worship. And we're going to look at King David as setting the example for us in that. And it will be a Sunday you'll never forget. So that's 2 weeks from today. That's July 31st. And at 11 a.m. right here. All right? Got it? All right. So don't miss that. With all that said, we've been in a series going through the book of Daniel. It's a 10-week series that we've been doing this chapter by chapter. Next week, we'll wrap up the series with week 10, which I'm calling The End. And that's the name of the message, but it's also the end of this series. I'm not saying it's the end of the world, so don't freak out on me, although it is getting closer. And if I were to predict that would be the end of the world, then it wouldn't be that day because Jesus said no one knows the day. So I can guarantee you, if I predicted the day or anyone else, it won't happen on that day, but it could happen the day before or the day after. Okay, so, but the end is coming, and we'll talk about that next week, but we're also going to talk about that some today. In 2 weeks, I'll be doing a short message on passionate worship while we have the worship and dance group here at 11 o'clock as well, so you won't want to miss that Sunday. Today, week 9, I want to talk about angels and wars. Our key verse for this series has been Daniel chapter 6, verse 26b through 27a. If you would, let's all say it together, big and loud off the screen here together. I hope you're memorizing this, a great truth of the Lord in these verses here. Ready? Here we go. Let's say it together. Daniel 6, 26b through 27a. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on earth. Let's pray. Lord, we're so thankful that you are the one true God, that you perform signs in the heavens and on earth, that you're going to have victory at the end. Lord, as we open your word right now, we pray that you would focus our hearts and minds on you, that you would speak to us through your Spirit, that you would teach us and help us to understand. Spirit, speak through me. May these be your words, not mine. May you receive the glory and honor, and may your kingdom grow, and may your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, may our answer to you be yes, even before you ask us what you want us to tell us what you want us to do today. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Well, in this series, we've looked at the reality that our culture and our country is becoming more and more ungodly. That being a reality, it's becoming more challenging for those of us who are followers of Christ sometimes to stand up for Christ and for what's true and what's right. However, there couldn't be a time in history where it's more critical for those of us who are followers of Jesus to stand up for Christ. And so that's what we've been learning as we've been going through the book of Daniel. We realized that Daniel lived in a very ungodly culture where people had nothing to do with the true God and they were against the true God. They were persecuting, even trying to kill those who were followers of the one true God. Yet Daniel stood strong. He kept his faith in God. He recognized that God had called him to be a light in the darkness and he lived for the Lord. What we're learning in this series is how to do the same. We're learning from Daniel how to stand up for what matters most. We're learning how to be a part of the winning team, the only kingdom that's going to last forever, which is the kingdom of Jesus. We're learning how to do that in an effective way in a culture that has turned their back on the one true God. So that's where we've been going with this series. Well, today as we talk about angels and wars, I have to tell you about a crazy experience that I had years ago. This would have been probably not quite 15 years ago. I was pastoring a church in Kansas, and there was this young couple that had started coming to our church. Their names were Travis and Jay Davis, and they had several little kids, and they invited Julie and I over to their house for supper and just talk with us. And basically they said, God has sent us to you and to this church, and we're here to do whatever you need. Like literally, anything you need, we're here to do and help with. So you seek the Lord and whatever He shows you, we'll do. One of the most remarkable experiences I've ever had in my life, to be honest with you. Now, over the period of time, he said, I want to meet with you every week and I want to pray. I want to be your prayer partner. I want to pray with you for anything that you need prayer for. And so he would come, he would take time off of his job to come to the office to meet with me and pray with me. Who does that? And he would do this because he said, this is what God has called me to do, to support you in what God has called you to do. This freaked me out so much that I did something that may surprise you and may make you think I'm a little loony. I looked him in the eye one of those days and I said, Travis, will you tell me the truth if I ask you something? And he said, yeah. And I said, are you an angel? Like I was as serious as I could be. And he laughed. He said, no, I'm not an angel. But I was sent by God to help you in what God's called you to do. Now, I was a little embarrassed having asked him that afterwards, but nonetheless, do you know that the Bible says that angels are ministering spirits sent by God to help those who are His followers working for His kingdom? That's a true thing. Matter of fact, the Bible says that there are times that you may entertain an angel, have a conversation with them, maybe even have them at your house, and not even know it was an angel. That's a crazy thought, huh? You know, there is a pretty high probability that most everyone in this room right now has at some point encountered an angel and didn't even know it. I believe that angels have prevented accidents. I believe angels have caught bullets. I believe angels have protected missionaries for years and centuries all over this world in different places from tribes that were bound to kill them, but stood back because of the army that they saw. That was a spiritual army, but showed up in the flesh, and they backed off. I believe that angels are real because God tells us they are. Now, I'm curious, how many of you have either had an experience or have seen something or just have recognized in some way, shape, or form that angels are in fact real? If that's you, raise your hand if you've ever had something that makes you really believe that beyond a shadow of a doubt. Wow, so that's most of us, okay? Now, here's the thing. I'm certain they're real, and what we're going to look at today is going to show us a little bit more about the spiritual realm of which angels operate in. The world that we live in, I like to parallel it to an ocean. An ocean of water, we see the surface and we see what's on top. What we don't see is what's underneath. The spirit realm is what happens underneath. It affects everything on the surface. And currents underneath churn up waters that we see moving on the surface. So while we don't see what's underneath most of the time, although God can choose to make it appear in a form that we could see like a human at some point if he chooses to, which he has at times, most of the time we don't realize what's going on underneath. And what happens in the book of Daniel is really something, because what God does is he brings what's going on underneath in these chapters we're looking at, and he brings it to the surface so that people like you and I who live on the surface can catch a glimpse of what God's doing underneath. Now, this gets a little interesting. Before we step into this, we need to understand that Satan was an angel in heaven. He was cast out of heaven because he wanted God's job. He wanted to call the shots. He wanted to be God. He wanted to be in charge. Now, there are scriptures that make me believe that 1/3 of the angels followed him when he was kicked out of heaven. Those angels became demons. So when you hear the word demon, all that is an angel who's following Satan. Are they real? Yes. They're just as real as angels. They're just evil. Are we to be afraid of them? No. This is where the church at large, I believe, has been duped for years, is that we have bought into this idea that we are supposed to be terrified of demons. Now, is demonic power real? Oh, friends, it is. Don't toy with it. If you do, repent and walk away, okay? Because it's real. You're dabbling with the devil. Ouija boards, all that kind of stuff, you get out of that. Horoscopes, get away from that stuff. That's not of the Lord, okay? You walk in the things of God. But here's the thing. I think for many people, they've bought this lie. They have this idea that, okay, so there's angels over here and Jesus, there's demons over here, so you've got Jesus and Satan duking it out, which there is a battle between these two sides. There's only two sides, good and evil, Jesus, Satan, his Jesus followers, Satan followers. Okay, there's only two sides, but here's the lie that I think many people have bought into. They think that Jesus and Satan have equal power. They think that somehow that they're 50-50 duking it out, and you know, they look around and they see all the wickedness in the world and all the stuff that's going on, and they get this fear that somehow, oh no, Jesus is losing. Friends, it's not what's happening at all. Okay? Jesus is God. He's God in flesh. He's the creator. There's no one greater than him. Satan has no power against Jesus. Jesus crushed Satan's head on the cross, which gave right to us for our sin to be paid for us to enter into the kingdom, to be made right with God. And at the end of time, Jesus is going to throw Satan into hell. And I don't know if you know this, but hell wasn't prepared originally for humans. It was prepared for Satan and for his demons, but then ultimately for those who would choose to follow him, which includes some people. So here's the deal. Jesus is much greater than Satan. Not a little bit, like completely different realm. Hallelujah. We're talking creator versus created being. Big difference. So check this out. Here's what we forget. Do you know when Jesus said in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, he said, "All authority has been given to me. Now go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I will be with you." How long?
Amen.
Always, forever. To the very end of the age. Here's what Jesus was doing. And then we see it again when he sent out his 12 and his 72. He said, "I take my authority," which, remember, Satan can't beat Jesus. Jesus has supreme control. "I take my authority, and now I give you my authority." We don't realize this, friends. So what happened was, Jesus conveyed his authority to us. What happened was, when we choose to follow Christ, if you've made that decision, the Spirit of Jesus lives inside of you. So if Jesus has the authority over Satan to stomp his head, do you, if you're a follower of Christ, have the authority to stomp his head? Friends, no demon nor Satan has any power over you except what you choose to give him. That's it. Only what you choose to give him. But you, if you're a follower of Christ, you have the authority of Christ. And you don't even have to raise your voice to command Satan or his demons to flee. Did you know that? Because it's not based on the strength of your voice or your personality. It's based on the name of Jesus. That's it. It's Christ. Our authority is based in Jesus, not in our own. It's not even based in how long we've been a believer. Someone who just came to Christ today has just as much spiritual authority as someone who's walked with Jesus since they were a little kid and is 80 years old. Did you know that? Because they have the same Jesus dwelling in them. So spiritual authority is about you being in submission to Christ and Christ's authority walking through you. It's not about how much you know or how good you are or how pure you've become, how holy you... It's not it. Now, all those things are growth processes that help you understand the authority you have in Christ, but they're not what give you the authority. The authority comes when Jesus puts his seal of ownership in your heart by his Spirit. It's there. So it's important that we understand this. It's important that we see that picture and stop walking around with some defeatist mentality as though we're doomed and nothing's going to... It's all... See, that's a ploy of the enemy. Did you know Satan wants you to feel like you have no chance? Did you know that? He wants you to feel like you're going to lose and like nothing's ever going to work for... He wants you to believe that evil's going to win. Friends, that's a lie. Here's the deal. Jesus already tells us the end of the story. We read that in the book of Revelation, and we're going to read about it some today and even more next week as we talk about the end. But here's the deal. We need to walk in the authority that Christ has given us. We need to understand that. We need to be a part of this great war. We need to be involved and engaged because it's real. One point for the message today, if you're taking notes, here it is. As you watch the great war between good and evil unfold and see Satan's power rise on earth, realize God has assigned angels Amen. To give each believer strength and peace and to help fight the underlying spiritual battles. Hallelujah. Friends, this is a true statement. And the reality is, this war is happening, and God wants to help you if you're a follower of Christ. He wants to help you be victorious. Now, as you read through and listen to that statement, you may say, well, Jeff, you just said that as the rise of evil happens, don't freak out. So you told us earlier that Jesus is so much greater than Satan, so why in the world or how in the world would we see the rise of evil if Jesus is so much greater? That's a great question. You know why? Because God said that's the way it's going to happen. God said, this is my plan. Now you say, why would God have a plan to allow evil to rise? The darker the darkness, the lighter the light shines.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Friends, here's the deal. Jesus is interested in taking people to heaven with him. Amen. It's his number one concern, to love the world and to save all those who would believe in him. He wants everyone to come to him. He knows not everyone will choose to. But here's what we often don't realize. When it gets dark and when evil rises, you can trace this throughout history. The church grows. You say, what? If it gets harder, don't people bail out because they're afraid they could lose their lives? Well, yeah, some do. those who aren't true believers, but are just kind of playing it. They're going to church, but they're not really walking with Jesus. They're just doing their religious thing. So yeah, those people leave. So what happens is the church gets purified. In other words, those who truly believe, those who truly walk in faith, they gather together and they trust God. And they're so convinced in a persecution time when evil rises and Christians are being persecuted for their faith, even killed. This is happening in other places right now. Today, right now, someone's dying for their faith in Christ. Okay? When that happens, those people who are following him, they are certain that he's real. They know that Jesus is real. They know Satan is real. They know the battle is happening, and they're willing to lose their lives because of it. And they're willing to tell everyone they know about it because they know that that person's going to face God on Judgment Day. And because they know that person's going to face God on Judgment Day, they're willing to risk it all to tell that person about Jesus. They're willing to risk prison. They're willing to risk death. Because they know it's real. I am convinced that one of the reasons that we don't share Christ with other people to the extent that Christ has called us to, because I'm not certain how much we believe that he and the Great War is real. I think sometimes we get caught up in our little worlds and we think, you know, it's just me doing my little thing, trying to make enough money to make ends meet, trying to take care of my family, trying to... Now, granted, friends, those are all things that we have to do, but here's the deal. That's not why we live. So this is one of the ways Satan confuses us. He gets us to think that the purpose of life is to survive. Friends, the purpose of life was never to just survive. The purpose of life was to love God and point others to him. Amen. That's it. There is no other purpose. If we don't get that purpose, we've been duped by the enemy. Okay? We've got to get about what the Lord is about. The Lord is about this great war. The Lord is about taking people on his side and ultimately bringing his people to victory and bringing as many people into his kingdom as possible. If God's about that, and if you and I claim to be followers of God, should we be about that? We better be. All right. So with that said, let's step into the message here today. Daniel chapter 10, we're just going to read through chapter 10, and then we're going to highlight the key pieces or points of chapter 11 as we walk through this today. So we're watching this rise, the great war between good and evil unfold. We're seeing Satan's rise in power on earth. We're seeing wickedness rise. We see that. You know, how many of you turn on the TV recently, you see what happens in France, you see what's happening all over, and you go, something's going on. Friends, I got to tell you something. We just... Man, we had a couple here first hour, sat right back there in those back two chairs. Do you know why they were here today? You don't, but I'm fixing to tell you. They don't go to church. Okay? They had a little bit of Catholic background years ago. 24, 29-year-olds, they don't go to church. Young couple with several little kids. You know why they were here today? Because they are scared to death of what they're seeing happen in this world. That's what they told me out there in the hallway. They're scared to death of what they're seeing happen in this world, and they really think they need to be on the Lord's side in this whole thing. What is that? Friends, we went garage sailing the other day. Here we were walking around our neighborhood random, stepping into people's places. And I've started doing something to initiate spiritual conversation with people I meet for the first time. Because I believe every time you meet a person is an opportunity to point them to the Lord or away from the Lord. Do you realize that? God's given you an opportunity to do spiritual warfare every time you meet an individual. You either point them towards him or away from them based on your action, your attitude, what you say, what you do, how you live. So the question is, how are you doing warfare for the Lord? How are you pointing people to the Lord and gaining ground for Jesus with every interaction you have? I believe we need to take this very, very seriously. And so what God's convicted me of is, here's how it happened. So I was at the rec center here about 6 months ago, and I said to this lady who I'd never met before, how are you doing today? And she said something to me, and she said, how are you doing? And I said, not too bad. She looked me in the eyes, and this is what she said. So you're about half good? I went, That haunted me for 2 weeks. I prayed, I sought the Lord in my quiet times, reading the Word each morning, and I'm going, God, what do I say to people? I mean, here I am claiming to be a follower of Christ, and I'm coming across pessimistic. I'm not even optimistic in the way I respond to people. So I'm going, so I said, Lord, I said, what do I do? What do I tell people? And so in my heart, I'm thinking, well, you know what? I want to be a witness for Christ the first time I meet someone. Every time I want a witness for Christ. So what can I say? So I thought, well, you know what? I could say I'm blessed. So I started doing that. You know, I'm blessed. Well, here's what I noticed. When I would go to people who were lost, which is most people I'm going to, and they hear you say blessed, they kind of look back. And unless they're a believer, if they're a believer, they're like, oh, I'm so blessed too. And you get this kindred spirit thing, which is cool, which I don't mind that. But those people are already going to heaven. They're not my target. My target is those who don't know Christ. So I thought, blessed isn't working for talking to non-believers. And then I watched this video and I saw this guy and I just happened to notice what he said in this video when a cake baker lady reached across the counter and she's like, how are you doing today? And he said, better than I deserve. And I went, he just told that lost person that he was blessed, but he did it in a way that a lost person understands, and he's going to make that lost person think. And I thought, ooh, I got to try this. So here I was in Sprouts 2 days ago, and I'm going through the cash register line, and the lady, I see her name tag, and by the way, we should do this, friends. You're not at the grocery store to buy groceries. Really listen to me. You're there to point someone to Jesus.
Amen.
So you look at the name tag, you call them by name, you show them that you care about them, and you start conversation. So I said, how are you doing today? And I don't remember her name right now, but I called her by name. And she said, oh, well, I'm okay. And she said, how are you doing? And I kind of heard that in her voice, which she was lying to me, which I later found out. And she said, how are you doing? And I said, better than I deserve. And she said, well, that's a strange answer. She's like, what do you mean you're better than you deserve? And I had no clue what to say. I'm like, I wasn't ready. I'd said this several times, but no one ever said, well, what do you mean by that? I had someone tell me, no, you're not. I've had people tell me, okay, but I didn't. I've never had a, what do you mean by that? And there's this long line of people behind us, so I know I don't have a long time. So I said, and I'm getting red from I'm just red. I know she's just going, you don't even know what you're. And I said, Lord, this is one of those speed prayers. Lord, I need your help. What do I say? And here's what came out of my mouth. I've made a lot of mistakes in my life, and I deserve hell. But Jesus came and died for me, and he gave me what I don't deserve, which is heaven. And she's like, whoa, that got real, real, real quick. That's what she says to me. She's like, you know, I have had one of the worst days of my life, and maybe you were supposed to come through my cash register line for a reason. And I said, I was.
Hallelujah.
And I said, may the Lord bless you and give you his peace today. She said, I need that. And I walked away. And my kids said, Dad, did you invite her to church? And I went, oh.
You are the pastor, for crying out loud.
I had a card in my pocket. Maybe I'll see her again.
Hopefully.
So I'm learning. I'm not the best evangelist in the world, but I'm learning. And I should have given her a card. But here's the deal. I pointed her to Christ. Here's the deal. Every person you meet is an opportunity. Here's the deal. If we believe that he's real and that heaven is real and that hell is real, we better be about the Lord's business instead of our own.
Amen.
in any of our own business that we do is really to give opportunity to be about the Lord's business. And I believe God's opened these doors because of something Miss D taught me earlier this year, which was this. She says, I pray the Lord sends me someone each day. And I started praying that. Lord, send me a person to point to you. Every day I pray that. Lord, send me a person to point to you today. So I'm starting to see every interaction as an opportunity to point people to Jesus. We all need to start looking that way because the war is real. So let's look at this war. Let's look at this battle. Let's look at what's going to happen here. Daniel chapter 10, verse 1 through 21. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a revelation was given to Daniel, who was called Belteshazzar. And its message was true and it concerned a great war. Ever heard of a great war before that's going to happen at the end of time? Ever seen a movie named Armageddon? There's a great war that's going to happen between good and evil. Jesus is going to win at the end of that thing. And it's not going to be a fun battle, but in the end, Jesus is going to win. I believe that's what this is talking about, is about the end, the war that's going to happen at the end. I think that's what this vision that God gives Daniel is talking about. He said, the understanding of the message came to him in a vision. At that time, I, Daniel, mourned after I got this vision for three weeks. And I ate no choice food, no meat or wine touched my lips. I used no lotions at all until the 3 weeks were over. When is the last time, friends, that you were so overtaken by something that you mourned and wept for 3 weeks without eating any meat? This rocked his world. Why? Because he knew it was real. This was talking about real events that were going to happen. He knew God was real. He knew that the great war was real. He knew angels and demons were real. Verse 4, on the 24th day of the first month, I was standing on the bank of the great river, the Tigris. I looked up and there before me was a man dressed in linen with a belt of fine gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like topaz, his face like lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms like legs, legs like gleam of burnished bronze, and his voice like the sound of a multitude. Now, some scholars believe this was Jesus. Some scholars believe it was an angel. We see a description in the book of Revelation that is similar to this, but different. A few things are the same. More things are not the same, which make me think this is probably an angel, not Jesus. But I could be wrong about that. This could be Jesus. All right. My thoughts are it's probably an angel based on the differences in the descriptions. But there are similarities which could lead us to believe that he's Christ. Regardless, this is an agent for the Lord. Okay? Verse 7. I, Daniel, was the only one who saw the vision. Those who were with me did not see it. But I want you to check this out. Daniel's standing at the river. He sees it. There were people standing with him. They didn't see it. But such terror overwhelmed those standing with me that they fled and hid themselves. When was the last time you were standing there and God showed you this vision so crazy that everyone around you, even though they didn't see it, freaked out and took off in hiding? Friends, this is the real deal. God is showing up. Verse 8. So here I was, left alone. I'm gazing at this great vision. I had no strength left. My face turned deathly pale, and I was helpless. Then I heard him speaking. As I listened to him, I fell into a deep sleep, my face to the ground. A hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. He said, Daniel, you who are highly esteemed, consider carefully the words that I'm about to speak to you and stand up. For I have now been sent to you. And when he said this to me, I stood up trembling. Interesting that he was sent to him, which angels are sent to help and convey messages to those who are the Lord's. It's another one of the reasons I think it was an angel. Verse 12. Then he continued. Now remember, Daniel's trembling. His knees are shaken. Then he continued, do not be afraid, Daniel. Which, by the way, throughout history, almost every time we see an angel appear, you know what the first thing the angel says is? Don't freak out on me. Because when you encounter an angel and you know it's an angel, instantly the fear of God sets into you. And it's because you realize he actually has the ability to kill you. I was just reading in my quiet time the other day. David freaked out because he saw an angel and he said he was afraid to go into the presence because he was afraid because of some sin that he had done. He was afraid that he would die. Okay. So when an angel's bringing good news, the first thing they say to you is, don't be afraid. Or when an angel's here to help, the first thing they're going to say is, don't be afraid. It's another reason I think it was an angel. He says, it continues, don't be afraid, Daniel. Since the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard. So check this out. His prayers were heard by God and the angels. So he says, I have come in response to them. Holy smoke. When you pray, do you realize that angels are going to be responding? You are engaging the great battle of all time. Whenever you pray, prayer is a bigger deal than any of us realize. And so a word, I've come in response to those prayers. Verse 13, but the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me because I was detained there with the king of Persia. Now I have come to explain what will happen to your people in the future, for the vision concerns a time yet to come. Now, what's all this talk of the prince of the Persian kingdom, this Michael guy, one of the chief princes? Here's the thing. There are angels are assembled like an army. Demons are assembled like an army. Okay? Because remember, they come from the same. It's just one serving the enemy. So here's the deal. Princes oversee segments of other angels. They're the commanders and commanders in chiefs. Certain princes oversee certain territories or certain areas. So there are angels that are assigned to oversee certain areas for the Lord and demons that are assigned to oversee certain areas for the devil. And they battle it out. So these princes are actually angels or, in some cases, demons. All right, but these are angelic beings that it's talking about. Now, what's interesting here is Michael is one of the chief princes for the Lord. So he was one of the angels who was the chief princes, one of the chief princes for God. In some ways, we see him as the leader under Christ of the Lord's army. So Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help the person who's talking to Daniel. That's another reason I think it was another angel. Here's what I think. I could be wrong. I think this guy talking to Daniel is Gabriel. And the reason I think that is because Gabriel is the one we see announcing things often in Scripture. He announced the birth of Christ. I think Gabriel came to make an announcement to Daniel. Could be wrong. That's my thought. So here he is. He's sharing this information with Daniel. Verse 15, while he was saying this to me, I bowed with my face towards the ground and was speechless. The one who looked like the man touched my lips. He opened my mouth, and I opened my mouth and began to speak. I said to the one standing before me, I am overcome with anguish because of the vision, my Lord, and I feel very weak. How can I, your servant, talk with you, my Lord? Which is often what people said to angels when they met him in Scripture. My Lord, they called him my Lord. My strength is gone, and I can hardly breathe. Again, the one who looked like a man touched me and gave me what? Strength. Notice what he says. Do not be afraid. You who are highly esteemed, he said, peace. Be strong now. Be strong. When he spoke to me, I was strengthened. And he said, speak, and said, speak, my Lord, for you have given me strength. So he said, do you know why I've come to you? Soon I will return and fight against the prince of Persia, which was probably a demon over the area of Persia. And when I go, the prince of Greece will come. But first I will tell you what is written in the book of truth. You know, well, we know the Bible is the book of truth, but I think this is probably also referring to the book in Revelation, the Lamb's Book of Life, that has the names of those who are going to who are following Christ written in them. You want your name in that book, by the way, because that's the ones that go to heaven. All right? God wants your name in that book, but only you are the one who can choose to bend your knee to Jesus. Give him control of your life so that your name can be in that book. So the book of truth. No one supports me against them except Michael. Notice the description of Michael here. He's talking to Daniel. What does he call Michael? Your prince. This really, really caught my attention. Do you realize that what, I think this is Gabriel telling him, do you realize that what this angel is telling Daniel is, God has appointed an angel to you? Now, I don't know about you, but I grew up hearing about guardian angels, but I always believed they were hocus pocus. Like, really? You got a little guardian angel flying over you, protect. I just thought people just kind of lost their minds. I was wrong. This scripture and several others showed me God has angels that he has specifically appointed to help specific followers of Christ at specific times. If that's not a guardian angel, I have no clue what is, because that is a guardian angel. He's there to guard and to help and support, which is the whole reason angels were created in the first place. Daniel 11, verse 1, we read, And in the first year of Darius the Mede, I took my stand to support and protect him. So he's protecting the Lord's people. And Matthew 18, verse 10, we see the scripture says this. Jesus makes this statement. He said, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones." These were young children of faith in the Lord. He said, "For I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven." You realize that "there" is a possessive noun? In other words, those kids each have angels in heaven watching over them. Friends, those are guardian angels. That's a statement from Jesus. You could take that one to the bank and cash it. It's real. Look at this. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 14. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? That's why God made angels. See, and I think some of the time, when we walk around with this defeatist mentality as though we're losing and it's going so bad and nothing's ever going to work out and I can't even conquer my own sin, you know, and you feel like a failure because you're forgetting Jesus conquered it for you. Now you just got to let him lead. We forget we're the victors. Why do we walk around as though we're losing? Why would we meet someone as our answer half good? We've bought into this mentality that somehow we have no authority, we have no strength, when it's all a lie from the enemy. Satan has deceived us and duped us into thinking that we're defeated. Friends, we're not defeated. We are the victors in Christ. He's made us, what's the term? More than conquerors. We're not just conquerors. We're more than conquerors. Okay? This is who we're called to be. This is who we are as children of God. We got to start to live like children of God. We got to start to walk in the authority of Christ. We don't need to walk in fear. We need to walk in faith. We need to believe God, believe Jesus in us, believe His Spirit, believe His movement. Trust Him and quit walking in fear and start walking in faith. You know what? The angels are on our side. We're fighting for the Lord. We're in this movement for Him. We're to point people to Him every opportunity we get. You know, the whole chapter 11, really what it talks about, I'm not going to go through the whole chapter, I'm going to overview it. Really what it talks about is the continuing on of this great battle. You've got Satan and his demons. You've got Jesus and his angels. You've got the followers of the enemy and the followers of Christ. continuing on in earth. And in the chapter 11, we see wars between the kings of the south, which were the good ones, and the kings of the north, which were the evil ones led by Satan. We see these generations of wars between good and evil, south and north, kings and believers being persecuted more and more. This is Jesus' prediction to Daniel of the end of time. This is what's going to happen. And it appears that during the consecutive generations that evil wins more and more until the end. All right? What do we see? It appears that evil's winning more and more until the end. That's the appearance. But friends, God is at work. All right? When we go through all these lists of kings of the south and the north, then we end up with a summation of the ultimate evil king. Some would refer to him as the Antichrist. Some would refer to him as Satan in the flesh. Daniel chapter 11, verse 36 through 45 seems to be a pretty darn good description of that. Here's what we see. This king will do as he pleases. Like the evil king of all evil kings. Will do as he pleases. This is at the end. He will exalt and magnify who? Himself above every god. Sounds like Satan in heaven when he was kicked out, right? And will say unheard of things against the God of gods. He will be successful until the time of wrath is completed. For what was determined must take place. He will show no regard for the gods of his ancestors or of the one desired by women, nor will he regard any god, but will exalt himself above them all. That sounds like Satan incarnate right there. Verse 38. Instead of them, he will honor a god of fortresses, a god of unknown to his ancestors. He will honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and costly gifts. He will attack the mightiest fortresses with the help of a foreign god and greatly honor those who acknowledge him. He will make them rulers over many people and will distribute the land at a price. At the time of the end, verse 40, at the time of the end, the king of the south will engage him in battle, and the king of the north will storm out against him with chariots and cavalry and a great fleet of ships. He will invade many countries and sweep through them like a flood. He will also invade the beautiful land. That's Jerusalem, by the way. Many countries will fall, but Edom, Moab, and the leaders of Ammon will be delivered into his hand. He will extend his power over many countries. Egypt will not escape. He will gain control of the treasuries of gold and silver and of all the riches of Egypt and of the Libyans and the Cushites in submission. But reports from the east and the north will alarm him. He will set out in a great rage. Sounds like a description of Satan we see in other places in Scripture. He will set out in a great rage to destroy and annihilate many. He will pitch his royal tents between the seats of at the beautiful holy mountain, Jerusalem. Yet he will come to his end, and no one will help him. Praise God! We know the end of the story. We know the end. He's going to come to his end. Satan's going to lose. He's going to be cast into hell along with his demons and those who've chosen to follow him instead of bow their knee to their Creator Christ. So, in view of all of these things, as we're watching this great war of good and evil unfold, we're seeing Satan's power rise on earth. Realize God's assigned angels, friends. He's on our side. He's going to give each of us, through his angels, strength and peace. He's going to help us fight the underlying spiritual battles. So here's what I want us to do this week. It's in your bulletin and on the screen. When fear sets in because of the rise of evil, which we're all seeing, ask the Lord to give you strength and peace. And his angels will help you and fight for you. That's it. Don't walk in fear. Walk in faith. Now, does this stuff really work? Oh, friend, it's real. We read of an event in history in the days of Elisha in the Old Testament where Elisha was a prophet of God, and the king of the Israelites would go to him constantly. He would give him direction from the Lord. The king of Aram, which was another area around there, kept trying to send legions of soldiers out to take over the Israelites. And they would send these bands out to annihilate the Israelites. And every time they would get ready to send a segment of soldiers out, God would speak to Elisha and would tell him what the plan of the Arameans was. And so he would tell king of Israel, and the king of Israel would foil their plan every time. Because every time they got ready to do something, he already knew exactly what they were going to do. So king of Aram gets really mad because he can't ever have, he can't gain anything on the Israelites. So he's sitting there in his court and he's talking with all of his people and he wants to know who's ratting them out to the Israelites. And guess what? No one in the room is ratting them out. And so they're all like, listen, king, we're all with you. There's this guy, Elisha, who seems to have this direct connection with God. And so, like, every time we want to do something, it's like God tells them what they're going to do, and he tells the king, and we can't do squat. So the king's like, well, let's go get that Elisha. So they round up their horses and chariots. They get their huge army to go out and to find Elisha, who's off by himself with his wee little servant. Just the two of them. And as this army comes in, morning arises, servant gets up. He looks out on the horizon. And he fills his britches. Because he sees an entire army coming for him and his leader, Elisha. And he knows they're doomed. He goes to Elisha and he says, Elisha, we're doomed. And Elisha says to him this, calm down. Hey, the number with us is way bigger than the number with them. To which the servant says in his mind, Elisha, you've lost your stinking mind. There's two of us. There's an army out there. And Elisha says, Lord, open my servant's eyes. And at that moment, God opens his eyes. And the servant looks out, and as far as he can see, all surrounding him and Elisha are flaming chariots and horses. I believe an army of angels. Amen. And then Elisha prays, Lord, would you cause that army to go blind? And God brings blindness over the army, and Elisha actually leads them to another place, and they totally leave him alone. Friends, I am certain there are angels and there are angel armies that are there to help you fulfill God's purpose for your life. To love Him, and to point others to Him. If you'll be about the Lord's work and recognizing that even though you might be a nurse or you might be an IT guy or you might be a stay-at-home mom or you might be a school bus driver or a construction worker or a mother-in-law, the Lord has placed you where He has for the purpose of pointing people to Him. Period. If you're about His business, then the Lord is with you. Ask for His help. Walk in faith, not fear. Walk in His peace. And you already know the end of the story. How many of you would say today, Pastor, pray for me. Just pray that I will walk in faith, not fear, and I'll point people to Him, and I'll rest in His peace with His angels' help. Anyone, that be your prayer today? All right. Let me pray for you. Let me pray with you. Let me pray for all of us. Lord, we're so thankful that You're real. Thank You for this event in history, these few events that we've talked about here. Thank You for Daniel. Thank You for his heart for You, Lord. Thank You for revealing to him some things You wanted to reveal to us. Thank You for showing us what's underneath the surface, the true spiritual battle that's going on. Lord, we confess that sometimes we've walked in unbelief. Sometimes we've walked in fear. We confess that as sin. Lord Jesus, today, You're right, we're wrong. Satan, we command You in the name of Jesus. You have no power over us. Flee. Holy Spirit, we usher in Your presence. We usher in Your leadership. We submit to Your leadership. We submit to You leading our conversations. We ask that You would open doors for us to point someone to You each day. We ask that we would be about Your business rather than our own. And that as we do the things we have to do, that we're constantly looking for opportunities to point people to You. Thank You, Jesus, for Your angels, for the armies, for the protection, for the help. Lord, help us when we feel like we're out there all by ourselves and we feel defeated. Help us to recognize that's just a ploy of the enemy and it's not true. It's a lie. Lord, open our eyes to see the angelic forces, Your beings around us, supporting us in the mission You've called us to. And help us become men and women of great faith. Lord, increase our faith. And help us to deny ourselves, take up our crosses, and follow You. And Lord, as we walk around and as we meet people, as I did garage sailing, who were just like that couple that sat in first service today, Lord, those three different homes, that each one of them, when I gave them Your blessing and peace, said to me, oh, I need it so bad right now because of what's happening in this world. Lord, people's attention is aroused. Lord, help us to point those people to You. Jesus, may they find You. May they become a part of Your family, Your kingdom, the ultimate winning team in the end. For Your glory, Your honor, not ours. We lay our lives down at Your feet to be used by You for Your kingdom. In the precious and holy name of Jesus, we pray today. Amen. Friends, if you're here today, and if you're not yet a follower of Christ, I am so glad that you're here. God loves you. He created you. And maybe today, maybe for the first time even, maybe you're realizing that there is a very real battle, a war between Satan and Jesus going on, between good and evil. Maybe something you haven't realized, though, is that there is a war going on for your very spirit and life. See, Satan and his demons have a plan to destroy you. And they're trying to drag you onto their side because at the end, they want to take you with them to the pit of hell, to where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth and eternal flames of torment. They want to drag you with them. But friends, the Creator Himself stepped down into this earth, Jesus, and gave His life for you on that cross, and invites you to acknowledge that you're not God. And in doing so, you step off of Satan's team. When you say, I'm not God, and when you acknowledge, Jesus, that You are my God, and I bow my knee to You. Lead me. You died for me. You paid my punishment. You rose again. I follow You. And when you die, you'll follow him into heaven. He becomes your leader in life. You switch sides. He gives you his spirit, which is his seal of ownership, his deposit in you, guaranteeing eternal life. And his spirit then begins to empower you to live the life he's called you to live and to be a witness for him, an ambassador for Christ in this broken world. He offers you new life. So friend, if you're here today, and if you've never opened your heart to the Lord and confessed and said, I'm wrong, I'm a sinner, you're right, Jesus. I believe what you did for me on the cross. Come in, lead me, I give you control. If you've never done that, it's not safe for you to die. But today you have opportunity to bow your knee to Jesus. It's the only decision in life that has the greatest consequence. It's the greatest tipping point decision you'll ever make. So if you're here today and you're like, you know what? That's me. Today, I want Jesus. I need him. I acknowledge him. I bow my knee to him. If that's your prayer, maybe for the first time ever, maybe for you, you've made that commitment, but you've walked away. And today is a wake-up call to you, and it's time to come home. It's time to re-bend your knee till the day you die to your Lord and Savior, Jesus. If that's you, maybe for the first time or as a serious recommitment, would you just be bold right now? Raise your hand. If you say, that's me. I need Jesus. I want Christ. I choose him. Praise the Lord. Friends, listen, if you just raised your hand, or even if you didn't, but you'd like to commit your life to Christ, you'd like to join his winning team, then I'm going to ask you to meet me to the left of the cross by the door there with the light on, and I'd love to talk with you and pray with you and encourage you in this process. So let's stand. We're going to worship the Lord together. And as we stand, I want to thank you for investing in transforming broken lives through Christ's love, like Edie, who you saw the baptism of earlier. Thank you for being a part of God's movement on this earth through New Hope. I want to encourage you as an act of worship to give and invest in the Lord's mission. We have tithe and offering boxes by the doors in the worship center. You can also give online, godhope.cc. But let's worship as we give. Let's be a part of the Lord's work. Thank you. And again, if you want to commit or recommit your heart to Christ, would you just meet me over there by the door right now? And let's worship the Lord.